Tell you why I'm starting a new series today called Fear Not. And so in that series, there's, you know, throughout the Bible, there's hundreds of mentions of fear not or do not be afraid or, you know, talking about not having that fear. And so we kind of want to look into that. We want to dig into that. Today we're going to dig into what fear is and why we can fear not. Why it says do not be afraid. How we can move out of that fear and move into God's grace and move into God's love. Next few weeks we'll be going on in a series where we'll talk about fear versus love, fear versus peace, and fear versus trust, and about how you can shift from fear to those positive things and continue to move forward in life. So I encourage you guys to be a part of this series. Pastor Adam's going to be sharing a message today. We got one more song before he comes up, and you know, he's been passionate about his beliefs, passionate about serving and making a difference in people's lives. And so I encourage you guys to tune in, listen to what he has to say. It comes from the Bible and is expressed with some of his experiences, some of the stuff in his life, and it's some powerful stuff. So I encourage you guys to check that out. I'm going to open us up a little bit of prayer. We'll have another song, and then we'll have our message. Father, we just thank you for bringing us here together. We thank you for those that are in the building, those that are online watching. I pray, Lord, that you will bless them, that they will learn today, that they'll open their hearts and their minds to hear your word, to be challenged by that, Lord. As we move into this Fear Not series, I pray that your spirit will speak to us, Lord, that we will adopt your spirit and we'll move out of that that fear-based living. Lord, I just thank you for the hope and the grace and the promises that you give us. And I pray, Lord, that you be with us now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. How about our band? I knew I liked that the Mercy Me song that they performed. And I like it even more now coming out of Lisa's voice. That was pretty awesome. And I had just looked up that song a few weeks ago. And I... because I'm a pretty big Mercy Me fan. I didn't realize it was like one of their old original songs that they had done. All right, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Adam.
Let me get back to the start of my notes here so I'm not completely all over the place. Good morning to the people here and the ones that are checking us out from home. Also, thank Terry and the band for... that song, Whom Shall I Fear, is actually from Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When evil men advance against me to devour my flesh, when my enemies and my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Because we're in unprecedented times right now, I mean, at least... you know, that's what they tell us. It seems like from our perspective, you know, the fear engine is extremely active right now. Do you guys remember the movie Outbreak? Like, it's movies like Outbreak and especially the real docudramas like Idiocracy. You know, it's those kind of movies that make us reflect back and say, like, wow, that wasn't a comedy, or wow, that wasn't just some stupid drama. But in the movie Outbreak, just as the thing is kicking off, this guy is sitting in the movie theater, and he's hacking away, and stuff's going on, and they just show this like spray coming out of him. And then with like computer animation, they show the little virus flying around and going up in people's mouths and stuff like that. Something similar actually happened to me, if you can imagine. In 1995, I was watching the movie Forget Paris. It's with Billy Crystal. And I was watching it in the base theater of our little base in Germany. And in this one scene, Billy Crystal, who plays an NBA referee, well, here it is right now.
Let's go, let's play.
Lembeer's got me in a headlock out there. What are you waiting for? Blood?
Technical foul! Who's doing
it? For what? Do you want another one?
What did I say? Just because you're having a bad game, don't take it out on me.
You're out of here, Kareem.
What are you nuts? This is my farewell game.
Oh, come on. Let me be the first to say farewell. Get out of here.
No. You're nuts.
Yeah,
man.
Really? Hey, what are you laughing at?
Nothing.
No?
Nothing.
That's it, technical for lying.
Are you out of your mind?
Am I out of my mind? Am I crazy?
You're out of here, crew. You throw me out of the game.
Take a walk, Isaiah.
What the hell's going on?
Oh,
hey, you don't run this league, Mickey. Nobody paid to see you, ref.
Nobody paid to see you do anything. Get out of
what?
Here,
what? This is not over, Mickey. I'm going to see you again.
Good, because I'll still have this.
Big deal.
You're out of the game.
What are you doing?
It was horrible. He snapped. He threw out both starting teams, a coach, a trainer, Kareem's parents, and the guy who puts the cheese on the nachos. They had to take Mickey out in an armored van.
So I'm sitting in the theater, and it's dark out, and there weren't a whole lot of people watching the movie. So I'm kind of like sitting in the front, and everyone else is behind me. When that scene happened with him kicking Kareem Abdul-Jabbar out of the game during his farewell game, I let out this laugh, and the thing of it was my mouth was full of pop. And the scene was kind of bright, and everyone's behind me, and this plume of pop spray was probably like 20 feet in diameter. It was enormous. It was like a constellation of Sprite. And, you know, looking back at 1995, that's funny, but, you know, today that would probably get me thrown away in prison. And I don't know if any of you are wondering what this thing is over here. It's kind of off the screen, but I brought this as another example. I was driving home from work one day. This is a giant barbecue, by the way. I was driving home from work one day, and I passed by the St. Lawrence church in Utica, and I noticed that the symbol, I didn't understand it. It looked like a dude on a barbecue. And if you look up symbols of St. Lawrence, he's often depicted either being on a barbecue or holding like a handheld griddle or something like that, which I guess is like the early biblical version of like a George Foreman or something. But I got home and I started looking into it. I wanted to see, why is Lawrence being depicted as being on a barbecue? Like, what are you celebrating here? And Lawrence was actually a deacon to Pope Sixtus II. In his role, he was charged with being in charge of all the finances of the early church, including all the distribution of alms to the poor. And it was a pretty horrible time for Christians at that time with the persecution. And in 258 AD, the Roman Emperor Valerian ordered the execution of all Christians, and he ordered it starting with the Pope. He said, I'm going to take out the Pope and the bishops and the deacons, and we're just going to go down the line like that. So he sentenced Pope Sixtus to be executed, and before he was executed, he got with his beloved deacon Lawrence, and he's like, listen, we got all this stuff. I know we've been giving away a lot of the stuff thus far, but all the rest of the stuff, you have to give it all to the poor. Like, shower them with it. Make it rain. Like, get rid of all of it. And then they executed the Pope, and the prefect at the time, the governor of the area, he told Lawrence, he's like, you got 3 days to get all of your possessions, all of your wealth and everything, and I want you to bring it to me. And so I guess he was trying to be clever, because on the third day he shows up to talk to the emperor and the prefect, and he brings people with him. He brings homeless people, and he brings sick people and people that are, you know, that don't have anything good going on, but except they have fresh clothes and they're well fed and they seem to be doing okay. And he says, this is the treasures of our church that I'm presenting to you. And even goes so far as to say, the church is truly rich, far richer than your empire. That's what he says to the guy. And this is probably like the first fart in church, because it didn't go over very well. And it's a good thing that Lawrence had a sense of humor, because what he was sentenced was, unlike most of the people at the time were being beheaded, he's sentenced to be, he went for the barbecue. I don't know if they were just trying to make an extra example of him, to have him die with, you know, through this horribly slow death of agony and torture. But we don't remember him because he gave to the poor, and or even because he was martyred. We remember him because as he was laying on the grate, and even many of the depictions of Lawrence will show him looking all forlorn, laying on the grate, and being all upset, you know, kind of very Shakespeare-ish. But actually, he didn't have pain. As he was laying there cooking, he was laughing. And he was telling jokes, and he was jubilant, and people were just like, we can't believe what we're seeing here. This guy is like enjoying himself. And at one point, he even said to them, "Can you roll me over? I'm done on this side." And he laughed and laughed and laughed and laughed. And at the very end, he's like, "I'm done." I don't know if that meant he was a little bit more done than medium well, or if he was just finished, but he said, "I'm done." And I guess, you know, it was kind of like the first celebrity roast, maybe, I don't know. But August 10th is the feast of St. Lawrence, and I don't know if they barbecue there, I'm not sure. But I actually, I do most of my Bible reading in preparation for sermons, and I end up learning a whole lot, and I gather all this information, and I'll show it to Steve, and he'll say, "Yeah, but the scope of your message was supposed to be this, and what you have is a 3-hour conversation, and no one wants to sit here and listen to that." But for this sermon, I actually started with 2 Timothy 1:7. "For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline." And that's a translation in the New Living Translation. I actually didn't know much about Timothy before I got in and started reading more in depth into this sermon. To me, Timothy, Tim was the weird kid that we grew up with in the neighborhood. I mean, that was Tim. He was the weird kid. But the Timothy in the Bible, from what I read, he's actually Paul's most beloved student. They were so close that Paul considered him a son. In the greetings of the 1 Timothy epistle, he calls him his true son in the faith. And the greetings of 2 Timothy, "My dear son." In 1 Timothy, he tells us how to manage his church community, and he tells him twice about fighting. He says, you'll want to fight the battle well, and you want to fight the good fight of the faith. And he continuously reassures him that he'll see him again. Now, who are the soccer parents here? I know my dad was a soccer parent and a coach. Football, hockey, basketball. I mean, we've all been in that situation where we have our kid and we're pumping them up, we're boosting them up for what's going on here. You know, that's kind of what Paul did. You know, he's like rah 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 with 1 Timothy. I used to love coaching. I actually coached 11-year-old girls who were diehard ankle assassins. And I'd tell them, kick at that ball as if there was no person standing there. And they were like, "Really?" I was like, "Yeah." So they would test it out on me, and then I started wearing ankle braces. But, you know, Paul sends Timothy out, and he pumps him up a little bit, kind of fills them full of good information and rah, rah, rah. But we never do a really good job of preparing our kids or preparing someone for what are you going to do when things are bad? Like, what are you going to do when stuff really isn't going, you know, the way you thought it was going to go? For some reason, we don't think that strategically. Right in the middle of a horrible situation, you know, sometimes we wait for that teachable moment. You know, it's like, we're going to talk about this later because we're definitely, you know, going to sit down. And for me, especially with the way things have been going on lately, I don't feel like I'm really doing anyone a favor to just say, you know, fight, just get out there and fight without giving them the context of the situation that they're going into. And, you know, we always think we have time for that, like I'm going to get to it later, you know. Apparently Paul did too. Maybe Paul thought that Timothy would be able to handle the rah-rah-rah, you know, fight the good fight now, and then later on we'll be able to get to some more context of what he's talking about. Maybe after 1 Timothy, you know, maybe he wrote back to Paul again, and maybe he was frantic, you know, like, you know, Dad pumped me up, and then I'm out here getting my butt kicked with all this anxiety and fear and everything. What can I do about it? Or perhaps it was Paul himself that was afraid. He was nearing the end of his time before his execution, and maybe he was the one feeling alone and feeling afraid in his situation. You got my map? Okay. sorry, I'm kind of going off my notes a little bit. But, I don't know how long it took couriers to get places back in the day, but, it wasn't just the distance they contended with. They had to go through kingdoms, and they were trying to be secretive. They had to hide and defend themselves. And by the time Paul heard back from Timothy, he was already in prison. Timothy visited Paul in prison, possibly even bearing witness to Paul's martyrdom. But then he headed back out to Ephesus. This image here is actually, for some reason, in Paul the Apostle movie, Timothy's not in it for some reason. This is actually Jim Caviezel, or if you're Lisa, Hot Jesus. And he's playing Luke in this rendition. Sorry, Lisa, I had to say it. I mean, so there's Timothy. You know, he's out in the real world, and he's feeling like he's all alone. He's facing giants and everyone's issues with all the rumors and gossip and opinions going around. And the Romans were coming down pretty hard at the Christians at that time. And, you know, there's Timothy being the bishop of this church. And I wonder how many times he read, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline." Who here has ever kept like a crumpled up note in their pocket or in their wallet or something where they would like reference, like look at it from time to time? I know I have one with like account numbers and stuff on it, but I've also kept other stuff. Like I have a dollar bill that Amber's grandmother or grandfather gave her, and it's just in my wallet, and I keep it in there for sentimental value. You know, sometimes we look at that stuff if we need an inspiration or we need to feel something. Perhaps, you know, Timothy, perhaps that's what he had. Maybe it was like a shred of like parchment, and he would look at it to remind him that fear is nothing but a burden of evil that did not come from God. I don't know why, but for some odd reason, the reason why I use the New Living Translation for this passage is because the New International Version does not mention spirit of fear. Most of the other English versions do. And to me, it seems like if you're not attacking something directly, with being able to see what it is that you're talking about, I think it's kind of an injustice for people. I'm of the belief that you can't defend yourself against an enemy unless you're able to, against an invisible enemy, unless you're able to actually put some color to it so you can see what it is you're talking about. Knowing the enemy of fear and how it will attack you gives you the target reference point. Open it up. Do some research of your own. Ask questions, and if need be, demand some answers. You point at that fear, and the greatest punch you got it right at that moment is to raise a hallelujah to it. You pull that rotten feeling up out of the shadows, and you expose it to some light and some salt. In Isaiah 41:10, we are given a really basic premise. God's word at that time for the people of Israel, facing unprecedented and dangerous times of their own, still holds true today. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Behold, all who are incensed against you shall be put to shame and confounded. Those who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. You shall seek those who contend with you, but you shall not find them. Those who war against you shall be as nothing at all. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, fear not, I am the one who helps you. And then in 14, at the end of that passage, he ends with, your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. Ben, go ahead and come back up. You know, we live in a country, the only country in the world, that was founded on the premise that you will not fear. And I know some people have some contention with that. You know, what are you talking about? Our Constitution was designed to address many of the faults of the past, of tyranny and fear being allowed to creep into our society. And our Constitution was set up in a way so that you're not supposed to experience that sort of forlorn experience. Our Bill of Rights was made to put barriers between us and tyranny so that fear might not rear its ugly head. And they knew that if it was going to last, if we were going to survive as a nation of liberty, the God-given no-fear policy brought to us by our Bible and our Constitution had to be preserved. So our goal here is the charge that you need to take away from this is fear not. Instead, acknowledge where your fear comes from. Believe that the Lord is with you and will not forsake you. And get your mind and your heart focused on living your life as a free Christian. I'm going to wrap this up from some words of the late, great Billy Graham. Jesus Christ commanded the church to fear not. Fear is mentioned in the Bible 600 times. It is no small subject in the Word of God. From Genesis to Revelation, Abraham to John on the Isle of Patmos, we hear the commandment being given over and over, fear not. That commandment was given to Abraham. The command was given to Israel. The command was given to Moses. It was given to David, who ran from Saul for years, who lived in caves before he became a king. The command was given to Daniel before he was entering the lion's den. That command was given to the city of Jerusalem. The angel Gabriel gave the message to Mary, to Peter, who was sinking in the swirling tide of the Sea of Galilee, to Paul, who had been on a ship for 14 days, and it looked like all would be lost. The angel of the Lord appeared and said, fear not, fear not, fear not. Let's pray. Heavenly Lord, we believe we're in unprecedented times here, but we also read your word and we can see that we're not only right in a situation that has been happening here before, but we've been warned about it. We've been guided, not just around these pitfalls, but to charge straight through them, knowing that you are with us. Help us to fear not and to keep our eyes upon you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
I'm not afraid. Yeah. It's been a ride. I guess I had to go to that place to get to this one. Now some of you might still be in that place. If you're trying to get out, just follow me. I'll get you there.